Okay. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Wyoming County Cultural Center at the Dietrich Theater. I'm Erica Rogler, Dietrich Theater Executive Director, and I would like to thank you for joining us for today's free Science on Screen showing of A Birder's Guide to Everything. This will be followed by a presentation on parental care in birds with Dr. Meg Hatch, Associate Professor of Biology at Penn State Scranton. This program is an initiative of the COOLIDGE CORNER THEATRE with major support from the ALFRED P. SLOAN FOUNDATION. Let's give them a hand. Prior to the showing of A Birder's Guide to Everything, Dr. Hatch is going to tell you a little bit about herself and what to expect in her program after the film. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Dr. Hatch.
Thank you for that kind welcome, and I'm looking forward to sharing with you this afternoon a little bit about my research and my understanding of parental behavior in birds, and I'll share a few pictures of some of the birds that we're capturing right now at Lackawanna State Park as part of my research. And then I'll get into the talk just to share a little bit, because it is the breeding season, to share a little bit about the different types of parental behavior and how human interference can sometimes cause problems with that. As Erica said, I'm an associate professor of biology at Penn State Scranton. I'm not originally from Pennsylvania, but I've been here 17 years, and I'm thrilled for this opportunity. So thanks, and the talk will be right after the movie, so I'm looking forward to it. Thank you, everyone, for coming. As you already know, my name is Meg Hatch, and I'm Associate Professor of Biology at Penn State Scranton. And I wanted to tell you a little bit about myself and my research at Lackawanna State Park, and then I'll get into this topic of parental care in birds. And you can understand now that you've seen the movie why maybe I picked the idea of parental behavior. So, I've been studying birds at Lackawanna State Park for the last 17 years in a collaboration with Dr. Robert Smith at the University of Scranton. We've been studying migratory birds. I'll also talk to you about the parental behavior that I studied, but I wanted to tell you a little bit about how one studies songbirds. So our sort of star of the show is the gray catbird there. And I heard some of you recognize it in the movie. And that's me looking at a catbird there. So we've been looking at sort of habitat choices in the migratory birds. We've also been looking at their arrival and things that differ between species and whether or not the shrub habitat that we study is a decent habitat for them. Next slide, please. We catch the birds by using what are called mist nets. Some of you may recognize this is a magnolia warbler, and you can see sort of the black mesh there. They're about 40-foot nets that we string between two poles, and the thin threads make it hard for the birds to see. So they fly into it, get caught, we carefully extract them, take our measurements, give them a bird band, and let them go. So that's how we study them. Next slide, please. So I forgot that there were all those great pictures of birds in the movie, but I thought I'd just share some of the wonderful birds that we've captured recently, just a few of them. So these are all warblers, and this isn't a quiz, but let's start with the one closest to me. What's that? Yeah, yellow warbler, right? It's aptly named. What about the guy in the middle, and that is a male? We've got an excellent person there. And what about on the far side? So thank you for that, because that's why I put that bird in there. So it does have spots like a thrush, but it's actually an oven bird. So it's smaller, and it's got the red, little orange-red stripe. Next slide, please. Go ahead and click. So this is the bonus question. This is a very difficult bird, and we just caught this bird on Thursday. It's a warbler,
But bonus points if you can tell me what it is. So folks are shaking their heads, and fair enough, this is a difficult one. It is a warbler, you can tell by the beak. It's got a bluish-colored wing with white wing bars, which is what you would see in a blue-winged warbler. But it's got a dark black throat patch, which is what you would see in a golden-winged warbler. So it's actually a golden-winged, blue-winged hybrid. In this case, it's called a Lawrence's warbler, based on which was the mother and which was the father. So a beautiful bird there. And just for fun, yes, perfect, this last one, that's not obviously a songbird. So what is it? Yeah, pileated woodpecker. So our nets are meant for these smaller guys, but occasionally we get something larger like a pileated. All right, just a little fun there. Okay, so I'm a scientist, so we always want to define what we're talking about. So what is parental care? It is kind of a dry definition here, go ahead. But any form of parental expenditure that increases the offspring's chance of surviving and reproducing. So what do you think falls under that category? Go ahead and speak up. Yeah, go ahead. Did you say red robin? Yeah, okay. And what does the robin do for its young? Well, we can see right there. Yep, feeding. Go ahead. Right, and defending the young. Go ahead. Or even just a safe location. And I just threw this last one in for fun, maybe for people, right? College tuition would be parental care as well. Yeah. So what I'll be talking with you today is simply what are the types of care that birds provide and the development of the young, because the amount of care the young birds need depends on how developed they are when they hatch. Then we'll talk just a little bit more specifically about some of those behaviors like feeding and defending, and then just briefly talk a little bit about how human presence can affect that. And a small little study I did with a student at the state park looking at the effects of a human visit to how often the parents feed the young. By the way, that was a gray catbird nest and an eastern bluebird nest. Okay, so what do I mean by types of care? Basically, it's how many parents are taking care of the young. So the first type that we're most used to is biparental care, where both birds are helping to feed the young or defend the young. And that's going to be most bird species, mostly what you think of. And that's generally because young birds need to develop very quickly, right? A nest is not actually a safe place to be, right? One of the things that are defenses of a bird is to be able to fly away. And the young being in the same nest, in the same location, that's actually a dangerous place. So a lot of birds with biparental care, you need both parents to feed the young in order to get them out of the nest safely, or you need both parents to defend and protect the young. Uniparental care, as it says there, as you might expect, is just one parent. So that's generally where the young are more mobile, and it only takes one individual to care for them. So quails and pheasants, as we'll see, the young are mobile from the start, and many shorebirds as well. And lest you think it's only the female, there are shorebirds where the male is the one that incubates and takes care of the nestlings, and the female is released from those duties. And then this other group is called other, because for cuckoos and cowbirds, you can see the baby European cuckoo there in the nest, and then the brown-headed cowbird there. They have someone else care for their young. So it's not that the young don't need assistance in surviving, but that they are having other species do it instead of themselves. And lest you pick on the brown-headed cowbird, just keep in mind that they are a native species. They're native North American species. They've had quite a bit of impact on some of our native warblers, but that's partly because we have reduced the forest habitat that many of the warblers nest in, and the brown-headed cowbirds have had more access. So don't blame the cowbirds. Okay, so this other care was also then, you're probably saying, what's a megapode? So megapode are Australasian species. This picture here is of an Australian brush turkey. And they do provide parental care in that they make these huge mounds, but they don't incubate the eggs. The mound is compost. You can go ahead to the click, yeah. So you can see the heat is provided by rotting compost. So they dig out these nests and then bring in vegetation, which as it decays and rots, that produces the heat, which incubates the eggs. And then they put sand over the top to keep that heat in. What you have in the upper right corner there is how most birds do it, how most birds heat their eggs. That's called a brood patch. In this case, it's a female vireo. Sorry, a female vireo. And so, I don't know how well you can see there, the vascularized skin, there's no feathers, we're blowing the feathers back out of the way. Feathers are good insulation, right? That's why birds have them. But that's not very good to transfer heat from the parent bird to the eggs. And so they develop these vascularized, so lots of blood vessels, and lose the feathers right around that abdomen area so that you have a much better transfer of heat from the bird's body to her eggs. By the way, this is how, for some of the species where the male and female look identical, we can tell the females because of the brood patch. But not all species does only the female get a brood patch. There are certain species, like a lot of the woodpeckers, both the male and the female incubate. So you'll have a male woodpecker with a brood patch and a female woodpecker with a brood patch. Right. And this is just showing a cowbird being fed by a poor yellow warbler. In this case, the cowbirds lay up to 40 eggs, one per nest in different species nests. Okay, so a variety of parental care. We're most used to the biparental care of both parents feeding. And as I mentioned, that depends or can depend on how developed the young are when they hatch from the egg. So you go from eyes open, able to run out of the nest, to eyes closed and not able to leave the nest. So it's a continuum, but there's sort of four points along the way. The first point is precocial, like the duck we saw in the movie today. The young are ready to go when they hatch. So they have their eyes open and they have that cute little down that we know that keeps them somewhat warm, and they can find their own food. The parent might indicate it or lead them to places to feed, but the parent doesn't directly feed the young. This is often the female is staying with the young, but the males can also assist in this case. Think about geese, right? You see both the male and female goose with their goslings. That would be another example. And there's one more example in the next slide, which is turkeys. Turkeys are also precocial. The young are up and running around within a day or two of hatching. Okay, so then we get to the in-between, which are the semi-precocial. The young are mobile, but they stay at the nest. So the difference with precocial, the young leave the nest right away. The semi-precocial, they stay at the nest and are fed by the parents, but they are covered in down, and they do have their eyes open. So as you can see here, that's a lot of, typical of a lot of shorebirds. And you can understand, like with the turkey and the duck and these shorebirds, why you would have young that can be mobile pretty early on, because they're all nesting on the ground and can be somewhat at risk. The next group then is semi-altricial. So we still have open eyes, but they are not mobile anymore. They're stuck in the nest until they've developed enough to be able to fly and to get out. So the bald eagle here is an example. And They hatch with the eyes open except for owls. So this is the professor in me asking you, why do you think the owls might not have their eyes open when they first hatch? Okay, right? They're nocturnal. They have very sensitive eyes. And I don't know this. This is just a hypothesis that it takes a little longer for their eyes, because they're so sensitive and large, to develop. So, yeah. So they're closed at first to finish that development. And I'll just mention, as you see, as we go through each of these species, I'm just giving you how long usually it takes for the eggs to hatch. That's the incubation time. And then independence includes how long it takes for them to leave the nest if they're altricial, and then to be completely independent from the parents. Because a lot of birds fledge, which means they leave the nest, but they're still not completely independent. They can't feed themselves. And that's especially true of this last group, which are the altricial young. So those are young that are born eyes closed, no feathers. Pretty much they hatch the size of the egg, obviously, and then they grow from there. So the parents have to feed them. The young cannot take care of themselves at all. And this is a robin nest that you see there. And just a little hint, you can tell that the chicks are probably about 2 days old because they're about twice the size of the egg, and they're starting to get a little bit of down. So the altricial young have no down on them until a few days into their development in the nest. Okay, just a little bit about, we said some of the parental behaviors include feeding the young. As you likely know, the baby birds eat generally what the parents eat, although the parent may make it into smaller sizes and little pieces. So young are eating the same thing as adults, except in a lot of the songbirds. So there are a lot of songbirds like cardinals and sparrows, where the adults eat seeds. Their primary food is seeds, but they feed the young insects like these yummy caterpillars and grasshoppers here. And that's, again, because there's a rapid development that has to take place. Good source of protein. Much better source than the seeds that the adults eat. I'm aware of one exception, which is the house finch. House finches actually do feed seeds to their young, in addition to insects. But even hummingbirds, right? Hummingbirds, the adults drink nectar, but they feed the young insects. And in fact, if you've ever seen a baby hummingbird, it doesn't have the big long beak yet that the adults do. Okay. But there is such a thing as bird milk. Doesn't come from mammary glands like mammals have, but it is a secretion that's used to feed the young. And so this is found in different types of pigeons. We have here in the picture a mourning dove. You can kind of see the two chicks nestled underneath. They feed that to the young when they're very young. And then once they get independence, they'll eat the food that the adults eat. So just don't tell the dairy board that we called it milk. And then just to get an idea, I'm sure many of you have seen birds in your yard or maybe on your front porch feeding their young. You know, how often is that? This is just from data we took from these three species at Lackawanna State Park. They nest in cavities, or in this case, nest boxes that the park puts out for them. And so on average, the young are being fed about once every 4 minutes. This is by both parents. So an average chips per day is 200. And as you can see, the house wren, which is the smallest and has the most nestlings, is going to make the most trips. The bluebird is the largest with fewer nestlings, fewer trips. But it's hard work. It's hard work to be a parent bird. And again, the young are developing as quickly as possible to get out of the nest. I will mention that all of those are cavity nesters, so they have a longer incubation and nestling period than something like a song sparrow or a cardinal. Those are what we call open nesters. So the nest, as it says, is out in the open. It's a little more dangerous. So those young leave the nest much earlier than a cavity nesting bird would. Okay, then another aspect, of course, is keeping your young safe. And I'm sorry I don't have videos of this. Eastern kingbirds are famous for being very aggressive around their nest, or mockingbirds, northern mockingbirds. Anybody been attacked by a bird when you're too near their nest? Okay. Blackbird, yeah, red-winged blackbirds, they'll do that as well. The gull up there, there'll be a following picture in a moment, but I have experienced being hit by a parental gull with the back of their feet. They come down and whap you in the back of the head, and it hurts. And, you know, fair enough for them. They're defending their young. And then, of course, you've probably heard of the killdeer. They do what's called a broken wing display, and this is where I apologize, I don't have a video of it. So the parent will leave the nest, which is on the ground, and quietly sneak away, and then once it's a ways away, it starts flapping its wings and making noise and acting like it's hurt. So the predator gets interested, follows the parent bird that kind of hops along, still acting like this, and once it's lured the potential predator away, it flies away, and then the nest is safe. So those are just some of the techniques. Of course, if you're something like a, this is just showing the gulls doing it. And if you're something like a hawk or an owl, you, of course, as an adult, you have very good weapons to attack any potential predators. Okay, so that's kind of the fun part of being a bird parent, right? You get to defend your young, you get to feed your young, but you gotta keep them clean too. So I just have two videos here, and I apologize that this is before cell phones, so it's a little blurry. This is an eastern bluebird. It looks blue enough to be the male. So he's going to go in and come out with that white thing in his mouth. That's called a fecal sac. So most of the songbirds, the young poop in a sort of sac-like fashion, which makes it easy for the parent to carry it away. Now, why do you think the bluebird flew away with the sac? Why not just drop it there below the nest? Yeah, the predator. So you don't want anything around the nest that's going to attract something. This is another way to take care of a fecal sac. So this is a gray catbird nest. You'll see the young don't have their eyes open yet, so they're begging just based on the movement. The parent feeds. And then as kids are wont to do after they're fed, he's going to defecate, and the parent's going to eat the sac. So that's another way to take care of it, right? And there's, you know, it's not very well digested. There's some nutrition. And believe it or not, there have been some studies where people looked at why certain species are more likely to swallow the sac than to take it away. But, you know, it's a convenient way to deal with that. All right. So now that we know a little bit about the different types of behavior, I just wanted to talk a little bit about human disturbance. We all know that humans have started to be in more contact, off-roading, recreation, but also loss of habitat is bringing the birds closer to us, or us closer to them. And there's several things or ways that birds could respond. It could be an aversive experience, so the birds take up and leave and leave their nests. But it can also be attractive. So around most human habitations, we can talk about cats another time, but in terms of wild predators, most human habitations, there are not a lot of wild predators around, so it's a safe place. And we're messy, right? We enjoy watching the birds, and we provide food. So some birds are actually attracted to human habitations for their nests. If you think about a robin, you know, up under the eaves of your porch or something, right? That's a nice, dry, safe place to be. But for the most part, birds mostly are going to be habituated. They'll get used to people being around. Researchers have been most interested in the effects of human presence on the parental behavior of large birds, such as hawks and shorebirds. And it's been found, I know this is a little dated in the study, but it's been found that bald eagles especially are very sensitive to human presence around their nests. In this particular study, they found a 50%, which is quite a large decrease in the amount of time the parents spent maintaining the nest, and a 30% decrease in time. Not only they fed their young, but they fed themselves. So the best way to observe a bald eagle nest is the next slide, is just take advantage of one of these amazing nest cameras. This is just one, allaboutbirds.org. If you're interested in information, general information about birds, it's great, by Cornell University. The DCNR, Department of Conservation and Natural Resources, also has some eagle cams, and that's the best way to enjoy them. So please don't get upset if your favorite trail or boating area is closed off during the eagle season, because they really do get bothered by people. But so with a student of mine early on when I was at the park, we were interested in looking at, okay, there's been documentation that some of these larger birds, and you may have heard of also, you know, beaches where plovers are nesting, and they'll fence it off as well, because it's difficult for the plovers to raise their young when they're being disturbed by people. But we were interested, what about our backyard birds? And I hid the names, but you guys all know it's eastern bluebird, tree swallow, and house wren. We were interested, the student and I were interested, okay, what about these littler birds? These common birds that are in our backyards, do they change their behavior in the presence of a human? So these were, did this over a couple years at Lackawanna State Park. These, again, are all cavity nesting species, so they're nesting in the boxes there at the park. We can go ahead to the next slide. Yeah, I won't tell you how long ago that was, but you can tell. What the student and I did is that we photographed the parental behavior, so just the number of feeding trips to the nest, for 2 hours. And for one of those hours, the nest had been visited. We walked up, opened the box, checked the contents, and then walked away. And the other hour, nobody touched it or came near. And we alternated whether we visited the nest first or whether we left it alone and just photographed it first. And so we were just interested in whether that affected the number of trips, feeding trips they made, and also just the time the bird spent on the box, in the box, or away from the box. Like maybe visiting scares them away for a little bit of time. So there's just some brief graphs here, and I know it's not a large sample size, but we have our three species on the bottom, eastern bluebird, house wren, and tree swallow, and just the number of trips per hour they made. And you can see that in the hour after the visit is in black, and the hour when nobody went to the box is in gray. And you can see the eastern bluebirds didn't really affect their trips, but the house wrens reduced their trip on average by about 6 to 7 trips to the nest. And it was also significant for the tree swallows. They reduced the number of trips that they were feeding the young after the visit. That this was mostly because they spent a little more time in the box. For the house wrens, it was significant. For the other species, it wasn't. But when somebody visited the nest, they spent more time inside the nest. The other two measures were the time on the box, which is the next slide, and the time away from the box. There was no real difference. I know with the tree swallow, it looks like, right, that's a big difference. But with only 8 birds, that could have been just one bird that skewed it, and so it wasn't what we call statistically significant. It's not a real difference. It just looks like that. And they didn't spend any more time away from the box versus the visit, no visit. So we were comparing the birds to themselves, not to each other. But keep in mind, going back to that first graph where the eastern bluebirds didn't really have an effect and the house wrens did, if you remember that table and the number of feeding visits, the wrens were making about 27 visits per hour. The bluebirds were making 14 visits per hour. So who has more room to adjust? It's going to be the house wrens, right? So in a way, they had more room to have an effect than the bluebirds. and the tree swallows. So I'll just finish by saying that please do enjoy the birds, and if you do have nest boxes, it's okay to take a peek every once in a while. You just don't want to do it too frequently. And if you have, say, a robin nesting in a shrub or on your porch, and they fly off every time you walk out, don't worry. They generally raise their young just fine. Just, you know, kind of keep your distance. And if you do find a baby bird, if it's feathered and, you know, eyes open and all that, the best thing is to leave it alone. Try to keep any pets away. But the young fledge, especially in birds like robins and other songbirds, they fledge before they really can fly all that well. Because again, remember, staying place in the nest is kind of dangerous. So if you find a fully feathered young bird, leave it alone. The parents know where it is. The parents will feed it. It will be fine. If you find a young bird that isn't fully feathered, it's not completely covered in feathers, if possible, that one is okay to try and find the nest and put it back in. Many of us think that by touching the bird, the parents will reject it, but actually the birds aren't smelling that. They're not like mammals, and they will take the young back. Worst case scenario, you can look up. There are some wildlife rehabilitation places, but not a lot of them are able to take baby birds. As we've seen, it's a lot of work to be a parent bird, and so if at all possible, return it to the nest. And just acknowledging all, if many of the pictures were not my own, and the references.
Do you have any questions? Yeah. So the question was about the brood patch, and that once the female or male is done incubating, do the feathers grow back? And the answer is yes. So the brood patch develops over several days, and then it's highly vascularized, and yes, then once they're feeding young, it goes back to being less vascularized, and the feathers grow in again. And it's just sort of the down feathers, not what we call the contour or the main feathers. It's just the feathers underneath. And thank you for that question, because it reminds me, if you've ever seen a bird return to the nest to incubate, she kind of wiggles around, right? She doesn't just sit right down. And that's to make sure that they're in good contact with the eggs. Yes. Yes, that's correct. So the question was, the person has robins that are attacking their window. And it's exactly right that especially the male robins, they see that and they don't know that's not them. And they think it's a handsome looking guy that they need to run off. So yes, and unfortunately there's not a lot you can do unless you can do something to reduce the reflection. And of course when it's a mirror on your car or something like that, yeah, there's not much you can do. The lady in the white had a question. No, so the question was about the function of the brood patch on the birds. And that's to incubate the eggs. So yeah, it's not a source of food. Yeah, so it's not a source of food, but it's a way to transfer heat. Although you may know that some shorebirds will actually get their belly feathers wet and bring that back and bring back water for their young that way with their breast feathers. Yeah. Okay. Thank you for asking clarification. Yes. Okay, so we have a person in the audience suggesting if you have that issue with the bird attacking its reflection, that they were doing a scientific experiment. They tried using different colors of cars to see if it was that and not the reflection, and they determined it was the reflection. And they used paper that kind of fluttered in the wind, and that was able to distract the bird. Ah, so that's a really great question. So the question was, what about grooming of the young? So we talked about feeding and defending, but what about so in birds we would call it preening, and I'm not aware of the parent birds doing anything to help the chicks. Once the chicks start to grow on their feathers, they preen it and they maintain it themselves. But I really like that you thought about that question. Yeah, so the young will start preening and taking care of their own feathers. So the question was, will the young get insects on them if they can't preen themselves? And the answer is, yes, that does happen. And even when they do, one of the insects I'm familiar with are bot flies that you sometimes see, especially like in the bluebird nests. And the flies lay their eggs. And unfortunately, I'm not trying to gross anybody out, but they do burrow into the young, and it can be a problem. But with birds, well, I was just reminded that some birds do take plants that, say like mint, that have chemicals that can help ward off insects. And actually, talking about human disturbance, there's been studies that some of the house sparrows will take cigarette butts, right? Because that's nicotine, that's and other toxins. It's a good aid, and they will incorporate those into their nests as an insect deterrent. So yeah. So the question was, do different birds use different materials to build their nests? And the answer is yes, and that's one way you can identify the nest. Just talking about the cavity nesting birds that we studied at the state park, the house wrens use primarily twigs, right? The tree swallows will kind of weave some grasses, but they'll also pick up feathers. So tree swallow nests are low and have a lot of comfy feathers in them. And then many of the bluebirds will make grass nests, but they'll also use pine needles to make their nest. So yes, the different species do use different types of materials, and that's one way to identify the different types of nests. Great, well, I know it's a beautiful day, so thank you all for your time, and I hope you learned a little bit about birds and their parental behavior.